Excuse me. Okay, folks, part two of the Agrarian Republic. Let's see what we got going here now. Come on. Come on. Oh, man. There we go. Okay. Robert Fulton had a couple ideas. One, he developed a relatively new form of transportation, a ship that would work really, really well on river waterways. One thing that Americans were really good at was not inventing new stuff, but taking stuff that Europeans invented and making them work really, really well. And so this is one of them. He didn't really invent the steamboat. He just made it much more effective. He also was good enough with math to demonstrate that it's cheaper to transport stuff over water than land. And so the governor of New York, DeWitt Clinton, is interested in building a canal that would connect the Hudson River with Lake Erie. So you would go from New York City up the Hudson through this canal that we'll call it for the hell of it, the Erie Canal, into Lake Erie, and then bop, through the Great Lakes, and you're all of a sudden into the Mississippi River. So New York officials goes to Thomas Jefferson, president, and Jefferson says, no, this is your local thing. You guys take care of it. And they eventually build it, and it's a wild sensation, actually, before it's finished. They have to keep making it bigger and deeper. It's so popular. But the Big Ditch will be replaced very quickly by railroads. Yes, it costs more money, but it's faster, okay? Faster. How many of you have that, what is that Amazon called? Forget what it's called. Anyhow, that Amazon feature, you pay so much every month and they guarantee delivery in 2 days. There we go. Rather have stuff now than, have to wait for it. One thing about the steamboats is that they had to be careful about running aground, and the Mississippi had some treacherous sandbars that would come and go throughout the day. And so it was the job, usually of a kid, to hang off the side or sometimes the front with this big stick, measuring how deep it was. And there was this mark called the twain, and that when they were getting close to that twain, meaning the mark where the ship could possibly run aground, he would yell back at the ship captain. They would reverse course and try to go around it. So one of the guys that did this that would identify the twain was a guy named Samuel Clemens, and so therefore when he got old and stuff and started to write, he took the nom de plume from his early gig, Mark Twain. People typically at that time migrated laterally. Today we go, wherever the jobs are. But they migrated laterally. So if you started out here in Pennsylvania, you're going to end up in Wisconsin. If you started down here in South Carolina, you're going to end up here in what became, whatever the hell this is. I don't know, what's south of Missouri? Blah, blah land. I don't know. I don't live there. I'm not good with geography. And so when you moved out there, you moved there laterally because typically the weather and the soil terrain was sufficiently similar. So whatever you were doing back east, you can do out west. And that's going to be fine for a while there, because certainly these are all northern states. Okay. So as the people from here moved here, they brought their ideas on slavery. So no slaves here, no slaves here. Slavery here, slavery here. No big deal. Everybody is accepting to that. But what happens one day if a state wants to enter the Union that's not quite fully north or not quite fully south? Well, we got Southerners who say, hey, it doesn't matter geographically, because we got the Fifth Amendment that says that government cannot, take away your life, liberty, or property without, due process. So we eventually have this compromise written by Henry Clay, and here's what we're going to do. We're going to take the 36-30 parallel, the the southern border of Missouri, and we're going to stretch it out to the rest of the Missouri Compromise. Everything south of that will be free, will be slave, and everything north of that will be free. But to keep the numbers in the Senate equal, which we're very careful of doing, you know, whenever you bring in a free state, bring in a slave state, whenever you broaden the slave state, bring in a free state, because that way the number of senators from free and slave states would be equal. The idea is senators from free states and senators from slave states would vote in favor of what their constituents want. And so if we had an issue on slavery, it would never be resolved as long as we had an equal number. And thus, why bother talking about it if it can't be resolved? So they're going to bring in Missouri as a slave state. They're going to lop off the northern part of Massachusetts, and they'll call it, just for the hell of it, Maine. Well, this is Thomas Jefferson's idea on this Missouri Compromise, and he writes to a buddy of his, John Holmes, on this. "This momentous question, like a fireball in the night, awakened and filled me with terror." Abraham Lincoln is going to talk a little bit more eloquently about this in his House Divided speech. But what Thomas Jefferson is saying is that, you know, this country cannot continue to be half slave and half free. I like the name John Holmes. There is an actor with air quotes named John Holmes who plays a role in a movie in the 20th century that will play a part in bringing down the president of the United States, Richard Nixon. Come back for the second part of U.S. history, and we'll talk about an actor named Johnny Holmes. Guy named Eli Whitney, he was a tutor, found himself down south, I believe in South Carolina, tutoring a plantation mistress's kids when he noticed that the slaves were picking cotton. And it took a slave about 10 hours to clean a pound of cotton. So he said, "I will create a machine that will clean cotton." And he does. He calls it the cotton engine. And a cotton engine can clean about 10 pounds of cotton in an hour. So in other words, this machine could replace 10 slaves. And so he said, "Ta-da, I just ended slavery." What he did was the opposite. He made slavery now economically viable. And so those people who did not have a slave, could not own a slave, now could not own a slave. And so there's a big run on slaves, also a big run on Eli Whitney's cotton gin. And at this time, we have the massive use of cotton. 40% of exports in 1816, 63% by 1830. But it's not just Southerners. I mean, well, once again, people who grow stuff make money, but it's the downstream, or is it upstream? I don't know. The textile mills, of course, makes a boatload of money. The shipbuilders, the financiers, the bankers, you know, the people who loan money to these folks, to the slave owners, to the plantation owners. So Northerners are making a lot of money off of slavery as well. The economy is sectionalized. The South is cotton. The North is banking, shipbuilding, and mills. The West is commercial farming. There is waves of German immigration, and a lot of them tend to settle in the upper Midwest, especially around a city called Milwaukee in the southeastern corner of a place that'll eventually be called Wisconsin. Guys with the names like Pabst, Schlitz, and Blatz, who will eventually form breweries named Pabst, Schlitz, Blatz, and Miller. There was actually the very first one was created by a guy named Best, as in not quite as good as better. Best. Came up with a beer in 1844. He started selling it after a couple of marriages. into a family named Pabst, they renamed the beer Pabst. One of the best family members established a brewery called Plank Road Brewery, and they eventually changed the name to Miller. We got Schlitz, we got Blatz, we got a whole bunch of them, and so Milwaukee became known as the place where, you know, they made beer, primarily by German immigrants. By the way, how did you buy beer back in the day? Well, the same way that you bought anything. You would bring a container, and the owner of the establishment would weigh the container, the empty container, and then fill it full, whatever it is you want to buy, and then they weigh it again, and then there you go. Ta-da, and you would pay the price of however much it was per ounce, per pound, or per whatever. And so if you bought beer, you got a bucket of beer, and now you're walking home with your bucket of beer. So you want to walk fast enough because all the nice bubbles are disappearing, but you can't walk too fast, otherwise it goes slosh, 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 and you got beer all over the ground. Here are some early ads for Pabst Malt Extract. Yeah. It doesn't become Pabst Blue Ribbon beer until Pabst Malt Extract wins the beer tasting contest at the 1893 World's Fair in Chicago, and the award was a blue ribbon. Cincinnati was known for making soap. Here's a commercial for a soap. So the little white kid is talking to the little black kid that, hey man, your mom must not be using the right soap, suggesting that this kid's all dirty. Well, hell, that wouldn't happen anymore, would it? Oh, the good people at Dove in 2017 had an internet ad in which this African-American actress, look at that, she's smiling, she's having a good time, there's Dove, and then she's symbolically washing in the Dove, takes off her shirt, and jaboom, turns into a white woman, or a ginger. Holy cow! Man, did they get in trouble. Yep, they pulled that end down real quick. Here are some characteristics, folks. We got westward expansion. The cabinet members on the president's cabinets typically were nationally known. All sorts of protective tariffs, especially to help out the growing industrialization of the Northeast. Federal road projects, this is Alexander Hamilton's ideas, and thus national taxes to pay for these federal roads. Republican values, the first three, you know, you got them, self-reliance, thrift, and hard work. These all go back to the Puritans. More and more Americans were having fewer and fewer children. You don't want to be poor and don't have kids if you can't afford to take care of them. And so Americans realize that. And so they're having fewer kids. But immigrants were having more and more kids. So there was this concern about them taking over. Sounds familiar, shouldn't it? There's the private and public spheres. You know, that men operate in the public spheres, in the public arena. They leave the house to go to work. You leave the house to vote. You leave the house to engage in politics. Women were involved in the private sphere, the home. They raised children, they baked us chocolate chip cookies, they swept the floor. We do see a class division. There's not much of a middle class yet, folks. Really don't have a meaningful middle class until after World War II. We have a second wave of religious revivalism known as the Second Great Awakening. Now, we'll be talking about it, but here's a few things. Women were preachers. That's one of the characteristics. A lot of women were preaching the good news, and they were preaching equality, which freaked out the established Protestant ministers, and so they pushed back big time. And what's going to happen? Ooh, come back for part three. Here's a little ditty speaking about beer. This guy's name is Frank Yankovic. He plays the accordion. No relation whatsoever to a singer-comedian named Weird Al Yankovic. This song is called Beer from Milwaukee. Enjoy. Thank you.
raise your glasses high. Then you chuck a luck until they're dry and raise your spirits to the sky.
We're going to finish this up. Number 3 coming up here really soon. See you shortly.